Welcome back to Digital Learning Day Live. I'm your host, Rafrance Davis, and you're watching the final installment in a series of live and interactive discussions about digital equity. It's been a truly amazing day, and I'm so thrilled to have been a part of it. I'd like to thank the Alliance for Excellent Education for their leadership and efforts to organize this annual event. And I'd also like to thank all of the students, educators, and education leaders who are celebrating the day with us. We've been having a great conversation about digital equity as part of our series of live webcasts, and I'd encourage you to check them out if you haven't already. They are all available on demand to watch at your convenience so that you can continue the discussions on digital equity both on and offline in your own schools and communities. As our day comes to a close on the East Coast, it's now time to turn our attention to the incredible amount of participation that we've seen through local events and our online community. To help me wrap up the day, I'd like to introduce my studio guest. First is Zach Chase. Zach is currently a ConnectEd Fellow at the U.S. Department of Education and led the department's revision of the National Education Technology Plan. Zach, thank you for joining us. And we also have Tom Murray, Director of Innovation for Future Ready Schools, a major Alliance for Excellent Education initiative to support districts in personalizing learning through the effective use of technology. Tom, thank you for taking the time to be with us today.
Quite a pleasure.
Tom, let's start with you. There's been an incredible amount of participation around the country. And I understand that we've got some international events as well. Can you give us some highlights?
Well, these results are just in, Rafrance. We've had over 2,000 activities as part of Digital Learning Day, not just nationwide, but you're right, around the world. We've had 48 states, including and then as well as DC participating. We've even had events registered in South Africa, in France, in India, in the Ukraine. And even last week, as part of Digital Learning Day, Senator Daines from Montana and Senator Blumenthal from Connecticut, they actually recognized Digital Learning Day in the Senate and put a resolution through that passed unanimously. Incredible, incredible things. We've got an update even in our states here. We've had a little bit of a state competition when it comes to Digital Learning Day, the amount of activities. And I want to give a special shout out to CETA, the State Ed Tech Directors Association. They've been a fabulous partner in this. But the winner of our state competition was North Carolina. North Carolina had 294 activities that were logged specifically for Digital Learning Day. Also want to give a shout out to your home state of Texas with 260 activities, the state of Alabama with 257, and the state of New Jersey with 209. Also want to give a shout out to Indiana. They were a champion, and they had a tweet-a-thon going on to celebrate Digital Learning Day and the amazing things that were really going on around the nation that were quite incredible.
That's so amazing. I'm quite blown away by that, actually.
Yeah.
So I understand we also have some prizes to give away this year.
We do. And before we get to that, we want to highlight a few tweets as well. Some of the events that we've seen throughout the nation and for today. Danielle P., she was actually celebrating their 100th day of school and included Digital Learning Day as part of that. What they actually did is they were doing a brain break and saw a great image online of the students using motion and up and moving around and probably Go Noodle or a resource like that. Ann Crilly, she shared out they were doing in they had a meteorologist Skyping into their elementary class where those kids were interacting with a meteorologist about weather. And talk about using technology to really bring that expert into the room, but also to bring that to life. And a shout out to Mr. Fox's class. We saw that one. What they were doing is they had this beautiful image of this girl 3D printing her house for her pet turtle. And she had designed the entire thing. Certainly looked like an elementary age child there to be able to do that. Really, really incredible. A couple other activities we want to highlight. One, a huge shout out to the California Writing Project. What they're doing today, they've got over 500 educators and dozens of districts that are taking part in what they're calling the Digital Equity Virtual Annotation Flash Mob, where they're all talking about equity and going along with our theme there as well. One of the things we saw in Bartlett, Tennessee today at Oak Elementary, and they're taking part in a global math task Twitter challenge that the kids are taking part in there. One of my favorites that I saw online today, and quite an emotional one, honestly, just an incredible job in Morganton, North Carolina, where they are truly using technology technology to do amazing things for kids. At the North Carolina School of the Deaf, what they are doing is they're actually using a combination of VoiceThread and sign language so that those students can take part in read alouds, which is just quite remarkable, and a huge shout out to that school as well. As well as in Rhineland, Wisconsin at Crescent Elementary School, we saw kindergartners, and I have a daughter who's a kindergarten, so this one really hit my home as well, where they're taking Skype with another, they're using Skype with another kindergarten class to be able to connect. They're currently studying animals, and they're taking a look at animal webcams, but they're using Skype to collaborate between the two kindergarten classes. So as you can see, amazing events going around the nation today. We're so proud of the work, not just today on Digital Learning Day, but that goes on every day in our schools across the nation. So quite the feat that we're seeing there.
Absolutely. But well, we still have to do some prize work right
let's
now.
Let's go to the competitions. All day on Twitter, people are reaching out saying, what about these competitions? What's going on with these, and who are some of the winners? So we connected with Participate Learning, a great, great site. They're doing amazing things there. They were actually agreeing to give away an Apple Watch for a contest. But Participate does, they actually come together where teachers can collaborate on resources and share resources. They put together their own panel of judges, and we received word this morning that the winner for the Apple Watch competition was Kathy Gilner. She's a middle school teacher and instructional technologist in Fox Chapel Area School District and Dorneyville Middle School in Pennsylvania. And the team wants to wish her the best, and they'll be sending her an Apple Watch with that. They said actually the judges looked at her resources, and some of the judges are going to be using, because they're teachers, using some of the resources that she compiled in that collaborative environment. So Kathy, on behalf of the Alliance and Digital Learning Day, congratulations on that. I want to turn our attention here for a moment to Future Ready, because today we're excited to launch a brand new website for Future Ready and Future Ready Schools. So I encourage our viewers to check out futureready.org. On there, you can find a huge slew of things. Number one, we also are unleashing today our summits. We are constantly getting these questions since phase one. In phase one, we had 13 summits around the nation, totally free for school districts. We've got registration now available as of this morning for the summits for 2016. Encourage you to check that out, as well as a variety of dashboard workshops as well. And we've partnered with a number of partners to be able to make those types of things possible, as well as our brand new Future Ready Hub. You know, signing a pledge and going to a workshop or going to a summit is really important for districts, but it starts the conversation. It's what goes on after that in the district, the ongoing professional learning opportunities. So our hub is a one-stop shop for ongoing PD, from everything from webinars to ed camps to all sorts of great things that are in there for district leaders, from news and blog and the Future Ready leaders coming out of the Department of Ed is part of that as well. Just incredible opportunities. But part of that as well is the Future Ready is not just summits. We also have this very robust dashboard, which was one of our challenges here as well. And the Future Ready dashboard, which you can find at dashboard.futurereadyschools.org, in there you can see the Future Ready framework, as well as the five-step process for districts to go through to be able to do that. As part of our challenge, we called it the Dashboard Dash. We encourage districts around the nation to really go through all of these self-assessments that we have in there, create a systemic action plan moving forward. As Governor Wise, the president of the Alliance, likes to say, we really need to make sure that we plan before we buy. We don't buy before we plan. It's really an effort to help districts systemically plan in all of those gear areas to be able to do that. We're happy to say that we had 44 teams complete that. What an incredible feat, because these are not something that you go through in just an hour or two.
No, it takes time.
You did it
our
as a team as
yes.
well. And so what you can see is a tremendous amount of time, but you know what? It's good that time is invested. If we're using taxpayer money wisely as we are, we need to make sure that we're using every penny wisely to really impact that personalized student-centered learning, the heart of Future Ready and what we want to do there. With those 44 teams, as we're going to recognize them now on the screen, and you can see, we want to congratulate those 44 teams. There's a lot of work that went into that, many man hours focused on student achievement and focused on truly high quality teaching and learning accelerated by technology. But with that, we had in our dashboard dash, any team that completed that, and we had 44 of them, and they are all listed in here, was eligible for today's drawing. On behalf of the Alliance and Future Ready, we're going to be giving a $1,000 gift card, now that they've planned, to use to support some of their technology and what they want to do moving forward. So, Refranz, as the wonderful MC of the day, I'm going to ask that you, I'm going to shake that up a little bit, if you would do a live drawing and pick out the district that we will be sending a $1,000 gift card on behalf of Future Ready for going through the planning process. If you want to read that.
Sure. Oh, wow. The winner of the $1,000 gift card is Clearview Regional High School District in New Jersey.
All right.
Congratulations.
Yeah, we'll give them a congratulations. Clearview, that is fabulous. And we commend all of the work of the 44 teams, as well as the many districts around the nation. We've had over 800 school districts already starting to use that Future Ready dashboard. And a shout out to our coalition partners. We've got over 50 national partners that are working every day to support the children of the nation that we serve. And you can find our partners through the Future Ready website at futureready.org, as well as in the dashboard. And they have hundreds of free resources available. And we thank our partners for that as well.
Well, we thank you, and congratulations to Clearview and to the teacher who won the Apple Watch. That's incredible. We've also been getting some thoughts, questions, and comments throughout the day on Twitter. But before we jump into those, I'd like to take a few minutes to talk about the National Education Technology Plan. The most recent revision of the National EdTech Plan is very clear about making digital equity a priority for the entire country, and it offers somewhat of a roadmap for how we can collectively get there. Zach, now we get to finally hear from you. For those watching that may be unfamiliar with the National EdTech Plan, please describe what it is and what it means for educators and students.
Sure. Thank you, Franz. Thanks for having me, and thanks to the Alliance for asking me to be a part of it. It's been great to watch you all day. The National EdTech Plan is in its 20th year, so originally written in 1996. Think about what's changed in technology in the last 20 years. The last EdTech Plan came out in 2010. Think about what's changed in technology in the last 6 years. Tablet computers were not a thing you would find. We had a much different landscape for laptops. Wearable technologies weren't there. But really, it is the national plan. It sets the standard, the vision for what educational technology can be in this country. It is a call to action for educators, for researchers, for policymakers, for administrators, for teachers, for students, for families, for community members on what they can do and likely should be doing around technology. But it's also a set of recommendations and examples for the people who are already doing the work around the country and who are really saying, how can we leverage this technology to do new things? It takes as its focus areas three pieces. One, which will not be surprising to anybody who's been watching today, is a focus on equity. And that is an equity in four parts. The first being an equity of connectivity. And this is something that has been near and dear to the U.S. Department of Education, to President Obama's administration, when he announced a little over 2 years ago the Connect Ed initiative, right? And the biggest piece of that has been connectivity. And we've seen through the modernization of E-rate really working toward what we believe will be an accomplished goal of 99% of all students having access to high-speed internet connectivity. But connectivity doesn't get us there, right? And Connect Ed wasn't just about connectivity. So the next piece is thinking about access and access to high quality devices at a low cost and high quality, low or no cost digital content and resources and tools so that once you have that connectivity, you can do something with it, you can build and make. Then the next piece is one of accessibility, right? So having those tools and that content, are all learners able to access and use them immediately? So thinking about universal design for learning and setting expectations of born accessible so that it's not on a school or a district or a teacher to make accommodations and modifications and have to completely revamp a piece of technology that they've purchased, but that they have set an expectation for those who are developing and building these tools to say, is this born accessible? Out of the box, can my students use it to access high quality learning? Which takes me to the fourth piece of equity in the plan, and the one that is nearest and dearest to my heart, and that is an equity of transformational learning experiences, right? The research has shown over the last, I would say, 20 years at this point, and further than that in a lot of different ways, that students from historically disadvantaged backgrounds are asked to do much more passive things with technology than their better resourced peers. And the research also shows that when you ask those students to do passive things, that there is no significant impact on their learning. But when you ask them to create things, to produce things, to solve problems that are of value to them and to their community, when they're building, when they're making, when they're doing with technology, when they're producing artifacts of their learning that are not only important to their teachers and other educators, but are important to their families and their communities, that's when a significant change starts to happen in the learning. So really challenging folks to think about how they're going to plan for, as we talked about through Future Ready, how are you going to plan for closing a digital use divide after you've closed the digital divide of connectivity and access to devices and content? So those are really the big pieces of the National EdTech Plan, which is available at tech.ed.gov/NETP.
So when you talk about closing the digital use divide, I get chills because you clearly feel the passion behind that work. And those of us that, of course, in schools that are trying to do this work, it is such sometimes a very difficult path to climb in doing that. But I would hope that today that people can walk away with some great examples that we have shared. You talked about some of the examples that are within the National EdTech Plan. So can you think of some examples that come to mind that are highlighted as a part of that plan, which is phenomenal, by the way?
Well, thank you. One of the pieces that we, when we were looking at the revision of the plan, we talked to a bunch of people from across the country and said, what's good? What needs to change? And they said it was a great 30,000-foot view. But when I went back to my teachers and said, this is what learning could be, they said, but what does it look like? So we have, I think, near 50 examples from across the country at all levels, right? When we talk about lifelong learning, it's important to talk about our youngest learners and adult learners and everybody in between. One example that I love pretty tremendously comes out of Rochester, New York, one of the highest concentrations of poverty in the country in Rochester. Their high school has a class that is using online video conferencing software for a year-long class on civil rights and connecting with students in Tampa, Florida, and talking about what civil rights mean in their respective communities, collaborating with those artifacts, talking about what they can build and what they can do and what they want to do there. And I'll talk, hopefully, when we talk a little bit about leadership in a second, we can talk about how that came to be. Another great example, Williamsville, Illinois, great example of using open educational resources to shift how we think about what students are using to learn, right? So moving from a closed, locked down textbook that's printed to moving resources that are created by experts in the field, and by that I mean teachers, to say this is how I want to help students access the learning, aligned to their content standards, aligned to learning expectations, but also saying, no, I know my kids, I know how to make something that is worthwhile, and I know how to make this shareable so that other students, as you were talking about the tweets that came up earlier, Tom, so I can make sure that others are benefiting from the work that I'm doing now. And one of my favorites, one of the ones that I think gives me chills, is there's a high-security juvenile correctional facility in Indiana. And this is young women who are incarcerated. So these incarcerated learners, they're doing a pilot program where they give them some very secure tablets and have created some personalized learning experiences for them. They do an intake evaluation of where their needs are as far as learning, and then they personalize the curricula to help them access the pieces to get them back on track. I would argue that perhaps that's the kind of attention that all students need probably before they end up in an incarcerated facility. But the thing that really gets me is that they have access to their counseling staff within the center, right? So where there might have been a stigma, I think, that any of us could imagine with reaching out and saying, hey, I need help to work through some of these things, the young women who are incarcerated are able to contact counseling staff, and they've seen a dramatic increase in the communication that's going on between these young women and the staff as they're getting the help that they need, so that when they are released, they probably have a much stronger footing to be successful in the world. That's just a few of the examples in the plan that I think are exciting to look at.
That's truly powerful, and even in that state where that is, where they're in a correctional facility, there's so many elements of that we can use in our classrooms that can truly help students and to truly create that personal learning environment. And I think it's a perfect example of that. So we promised our viewers the ability to be involved with the conversation. And Tom, I understand that you've been capturing some tweets. So this is your time, viewers. Let's go.
So in the past hour, we've gone through some of those tweets and we've taken a look. So I'm going to turn the tables on you as the moderator today to answer some questions now.
All right.
As you've been asking a lot of questions, as well as you, Zach. So Mary Ottenwiss had asked today, what helps make digital learning a success? What is it? What makes this all successful? Refrance.
So my response to that right off the bat is I don't think that it's the digital learning part that makes it the success. It's not, we always, there's that phrase, it's not about the tools, it's about the learning, and people will tweet that for days. But honestly, it really is about giving kids the opportunity to have access to people, to places, to what moves them, to what motivates them, to information, to learning what matters to them in a really authentic way. And the technology helps us to do that. And it helps us to connect with others to learn other ways of reaching our students. So I think that is the biggest win that we get from talking about and bringing digital learning into our classrooms.
You know, the heart and soul of Future Ready is personalized student-centered learning right at the middle of that. And we talk about leading with learning all the time, but it's focused on leadership as well. And I know as we were talking earlier, you referenced leadership in regards to making this all work as well. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Oh, yeah. So here's the deal. Teachers want to be able to do creative things in their classrooms. And even with the stigma that we're under with certain accountability measures, and I know that ESSA helped to is helping to minimize some of that, there's still that kind of, I guess, leader-led idea that sometimes learning has to be in a very standardized format, and it has to be able to be answered with a multiple choice test that shows on a data sheet. And that's not reality in our classrooms with the world that our kids live in. So there has to be that balance. But for it to be that balance, leadership has to be open to it. It breaks my heart when I hear teachers say, if I use technology in my classroom, I might be fired because the state says blah, 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 blah. And that's wrong. And we have to change loosen some of the holes that we have on teachers and treat them as professionals to do this work, because that's what it takes. And they will make the right decisions and the right choices for students if we allow that.
That teacher empowerment was key, and I would add the student empowerment, student voice as well as part of that. Zach, what else?
Well, I want to speak to the if I use technology, I'll get in trouble piece. Every state in the country has standards that speak specifically to expectations for what students are able to make and do and problems they're able to solve using technology, the evaluation of technology, right? So there's actually an expectation for all teachers that has been set by every state to say, here's what your kids should be able to do. So I think that that's an important piece. The other thing I would say is that there's a professional learning need that is necessary there. We know this as far back, in 1998, there was PISA started to add a component to what is your technology availability in schools. One of the first studies showed that looking at math results, students did better on their math results when teachers had high quality professional learning opportunities that focused on higher level activities for students. So if there was just the kind of traditional drill and kill, no krill were involved. If it was drill and kill, then the learning stayed pretty flat. But when they were asked to, again, make and do things that were worthwhile to them and to their community, it made a huge difference. So we know that that's also true, which goes back to if we want our kids to be doing these amazing things, then we have to create the spaces for our adults at all levels, right? And that's one of the things I think that the department and the Alliance have really seen with Future Ready is like, oh, it's important to get school and district leaders in a room to say, let's explore in the way that we hope that your teachers are exploring, in the way that we hope that your students are exploring along the way.
You know, Zach, everything that you just shared goes completely in line with what the report the Alliance did with Dr. Linda Darling-Hammond in regards to the digital worksheet is just an expensive worksheet. It's not doing anything. The drill and kill is not doing anything. Focusing on that higher order, that create and that design. And great piece here. We're going to hit one or two more questions.
We probably have time for one more.
All right. We'll do one more question. So, let's go with Lori Steva. She said that the desire to try new things has to be matched with the autonomy to bring them into the classroom. How can leaders and teachers create that culture of innovation in their schools where teachers are empowered to try things, but they also want to shift their own teaching?
There's a belief that has to happen first. In our district, as we're going through the Future Ready dashboard and even the National EdTech Plan, we've been able to identify there's some spaces from our leadership to our teachers and also even our students who are used to the system that they're in that we need to make this shift together. And I think it starts with conversations like this that don't just stop at the end of Digital Learning Day, but continue throughout the day, throughout the school year, between teachers, between community members, between students and district leaders in order for that shift to take place.
And again, I'm just here to say that what Rafran says is backed up by the research. As part of the Future Ready Leaders Project out of the department, we did a research synthesis to say what does make this change possible. And there are four focus areas as part of Future Ready, right? There's the robust infrastructure, personalized professional learning, personalized student learning, but also at the core there's collaborative leadership, right? And so it's everybody coming to the table and saying, here's what our vision of learning and teaching could and should be, and then asking how can the tools help to inform that. So we also recognize that not everybody has the travel budget to kind of travel across the country and see what this looks like. So at tech.ed.gov/leaders, district leaders, superintendents can log in, take basically a brief survey that says, how are you doing on these things? And then we did site visits to 8 high-performing districts across the country that are really putting this into practice. And so leaders will get a personalized playlist that says, here are some things to start thinking about. Here are some ways to inspire your thinking. Here are some folks that you can learn from. We're bringing the site visit to you. So trying to do that and make it a little more possible to really envision what learning and teaching could be.
So to wrap up our Twitter town hall, thank you, Lori and Mary, for asking those questions, as well as the many, many thousands of tweets that went today on the hashtag DLDay as well.
It has been an incredible day. Thank you to both of you for helping to close out this segment. And that brings, of course, to the end of this discussion and Digital Learning Day Live. I'd like to again thank our guests, Tom and Zach, for stopping by to join us, as well as the Alliance for Excellent Education, Commissioner Rosenworcel, and all of our in-studio and remote participants throughout the day. It has truly been an enlightening conversation on digital equity. But I hope that it doesn't end here. Talking about it is easy, but the real work starts now with all of you watching online. We hope that today's discussion helped you to think about the challenges and solutions for achieving digital equity in new ways. And most importantly, we hope that you will continue having these important conversations in your local schools and communities to further support the children that we serve. All of today's webcasts will be immediately archived on digitallearningday.org so that you can go back and watch any part of the conversation you may have missed or share with friends and colleagues. Our schedule of events below this video feed has links to all of today's topics and online conversations, along with links to research and resources on each topic. I also invite you to hang out with the EdTech team at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, via Google On Air for a special post-DLDay discussion about the digital use divide. Thanks again for joining us. We will see you next year.